Hamster, that's cool.
Plus, I can always say I'm looking for the man who shot her paw.
Oh, Lord, yeah.
That's all. She's set for me.
For those that don't know, Deirdre told us she's going to beat us all.
Thank you, Barbara. Nice to have you up here with me. And welcome, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to all this morning. This morning, we acknowledge our kinship with all Earth's occupants, celebrating the ways that we upright, walking, two-legged wanderers share with the four-leggeds lounging, lunging, and leaping among us, with the winged warblers, with slithering, sliding, snaky beings, with circling cavorters in a watery world, and with those who carry their houses on their backs. We look so different, moving according to the way we were made. Yet think about it. We are part of one family sharing one planet. May this service bring us into a deeper relationship with the diverse beings in the interdependent web of all life, remembering we all have common needs for safety, care, and respect. Welcome to all who gathered here and who are members of our world. Welcome. My name is Susan Richards. I'm a member of the Lay-Led Worship Committee, along with Kat Robinson-Greeter and Joanne Polster, and with support from Reverend Althea. We lead at least one service per month to give our minister a break from the pulpit. We are always looking for new ideas for lay-led services, and of course, we welcome new members as well. If you have questions about our committee, please feel free to contact us. This service will be all about the animals in our lives, whether it be the ones we actually share our homes with or the ones we encounter outside our homes, whether it be the birds at our bird feeders or the ones we encounter out in the wild, a deer, a bear, a shark. A few of us have signed on to contribute our thoughts and feelings to this service, but if you are inspired to do so, you are welcome to join in during the reflection. Just one more thing. A couple of years ago, our congregation voted to add an animal ministry to our social action committees. The Unitarian Universalist Association has a national animal ministry, which has a website, sponsors workshops, monthly Zoom gatherings, and lots of resources to support local animal ministry groups. Our animal ministry has been somewhat quiet over the past 2 years, sponsoring vegetarian, vegan dinners several times a year, participating in the Nantucket Litter Derby, helping out with the annual blessing of the animals, and leading services like this. Once we get into fall, I'm hoping we can be a bit more proactive and have more of a community presence. Feel free to contact me if you have any questions or ideas about that. Okay, are there any announcements? Here he is. And you've got the light there. It is in the order of the service. It's a different chalice lighting word, so please join in with me on that as Peter lights the chalice. We light this chalice in honor of the animal realm, furred and hoofed, two-legged, four-legged, many-legged, fanged and clawed, gentle and fierce, wild and tame. May we remember that all animals are our relatives, worthy of our care and respect. Thank you. And I'm going to ask you to join in again for the next part of this service, which is our annual companionship responsive blessing. You have very few words to say, so don't panic too much. You are the people in this, and I am the leader. Ours is a world alive and allowed with the presence of creatures and critters. Animals abound, interwoven in our human lives and wholly independent. This is the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. Some of us have known animals who have saved our very lives. Sometimes this is a metaphor, sometimes it is a literal fact. For so many of us, we are better human animals because we have known animals as part of our story. Animals are not only cuddly and cute, like my little one that you can't see down here, but you'll see her later. They're companions of solace and delight. Animals are deeply wild, with the capacity to defend and to kill, even the ones we have pronounced tamed. Let us always show forms of proper respect for this wild way. There are animals in our daily lives whose labor makes our own lives easier, safer, more accessible. May we move ever closer to that ideal to live lightly on the earth, taking only what we must and no more. Okay, all together. We bless all animals. We bless those we know and love. We bless those unknown to us who have benefited our lives. We bless even the ones that can harm us, affirming with humility their place in the interdependent web. We affirm the impulse for humans to live in right relation with all other animals on this earth. May we honor our best presence as part of the animal family. Summer sun is shining. Please stand as you are able in spirit, or actually stand up.
Thank you.
have a little treat. My husband's going to join me up here. And we have the story for all ages, which Joanne a while ago rightly pointed out to me, Joanne Polster right here, that usually we read the story for children and children come up forward. But adults like hearing stories too. And it's for all ages. It says it right there in it. So we're going to read Hey Little Aunt, which is a book I read. I'm a early childhood person. This is a book I share with young children a lot. It was written by a young girl, Hannah Hoos, who was upset by seeing her friends stepping on ants. She felt that ants have a lives of their own and they should be respected. So she went home. She happened to have a father who was a musician, and they wrote a song together. I'm just going to read it with my husband. He is in the role of the ant. I forgot, of course, the antennae and all that kind of thing. And I was supposed to have I'm the kid, and I'm supposed to have a baseball hat. We left them all at home, so you're just going to have to use your imagination.
I don't want to tell you how many ants.
Yes, how many ants he's killed as a kid. He always tells me this, okay. Okay, I'm first as the kid. Hey, little ant down in the crack, can you hear me? Can you talk back? See my shoe? Can you see that? Well, now it's going to squish you flat.
Please, oh, please do not squish me. Change your mind and let me be. I'm on my way with a crumb of pie. Please, oh, please don't make me die.
Can you understand that ant language? This is the kids are always impressed with the size. This is the size of the boy compared to the little ant down here. It's worth to look at this now because it's in reverse later on in the book. The kid says, anyone knows that ants can't feel. You're so tiny, you don't look real. I'm so big and you're so small. I don't think it'll hurt at all.
But you are a giant, and giants can't know how it feels to be an ant. Come down close. I think you'll see that you are very much like me.
Are you crazy? Me like you? I have a home and a family, too. You're just a speck that runs around. No one would care if my foot came down.
Oh, big friend, you are so wrong. My nestmates need me because I am strong. I dig our nest and feed baby ants, too. I must not die beneath your shoe.
But my mom says that ants are rude. They carry off our picnic food. They steal our chips and breadcrumbs, too. It's good if I squish a crook like you.
Hey, I am not a crook, kid. Read my lips. Sometimes ants need crumbs and chips. One little chip can feed my town. So please don't make your shoe come down.
But all my friends squish ants each day. Squishing ants is a game we play. They're looking at me. They're listening, too. They all say I should squish you.
I can see you're big and strong. Decide for yourself what's right and wrong. If you were me and I were you, what would you want me to do?
And here's a picture of what would it be. This has a big impact on kids. What would it be like if it was a giant ant with you as the little, little person below? And I think we say this together.
Yes. Should the ant get squished? Should the ant go free? It's up to the kid, not up to me. We'll leave the kid with the raised up shoe. What do you think the kid should do?
Think about it. Okay. Oh, I'm putting this book. Thank you. Now it's time for a little meditation. I hope you enjoy this one. I did this a few weeks ago, and a lot of people came up to me and said they did enjoy it. As part of our UU religious education curriculum, there is a unit on a well-known UUer, Beatrix Potter, whom I spoke about at our famous UUer service. This unit focuses on her love of and work for the English Lake District, where she spent most of her life, and includes an environmental web of life focus meditation, which I have adapted to share with you now. We, like Beatrix Potter, can experience our connection with the web of life by both observing and imagining. Let's imagine what it might feel like to be a part of an ecosystem. Since Beatrix Potter spent so much of her life on the hillsides of the English Lake District, we will try becoming a meadow. Make yourself quiet in body and mind. Become aware of how it feels and sounds when your body breathes. In and out, in and out. Imagine that you are a meadow. What does it feel like to be the grass? Not to be on the grass, but to actually be the grass. Feel the sun and the breeze on your blades, your roots going down into the ground, pulling water and nutrients up into your body. Who else is around you? Now in your imagination, change. You are no longer the blade of grass. Now you are an ant. Notice how that ties into the story. Or another kind of bug scurrying on or around the grass. What is your relationship to the grass? Do you eat it? Walk on it? Hide beneath it? Once again, you are changing, becoming another member of this meadow community. Now you are a bird. Imagine spreading your wings and taking flight, ending up in a nearby giant oak tree. Feel your feathers ruffling. How does the breeze affect your flying? What will you eat? Might it be the bug that you were just a minute ago? Where will you sleep? Now change again. You take another shape, becoming much, much larger until you are the oak tree the bird was sitting on. Feel the sun and the breeze in your leaves. How does being a tree feel different from being a blade of grass? How do your long, strong roots feel different from the little hair-like roots of the grass? Who lives among your leaves and branches? Do they help you or hurt you? You have lived in this place for 100 years. How has the world changed around you? What might you know that none of the other beings in the meadow know? One last time, feel yourself change into another being, this time a squirrel running down from the branches of the oak tree. What do you gain from the tree? What might you give to it? Enjoy your ability to bound effortlessly across the ground, to scramble and leap through the trees, your fluffy tail providing balance behind you. What makes you happy? What scares you? Who might you see around you? As a squirrel, look around the meadow and then say goodbye to the meadow as you return once again to your human form, back in this human community. Okay, it's time for hymn 123. You can remain seated for this, Spirit of Life. That were expressed, we ask that they grow more joyful because shared here in this circle of friends. And let's remember to include all of our animal friends. For the sorrows shared and unshared, we ask that they grow easier to carry because brought here to this loving community. And now we have hymn number 175. Please stand up as you are able, and it's called We Celebrate the Web of Life.
Mm-hmm.
now it's time for some reflections on our animal companions. I have one up here, who I hopefully will have time to reflect about later on. You can't see her. Maybe I can give her a treat. Treat. You can kind of see her head up there. This is Gwen, who is a certified therapy animal we're part of a team. So we do visit people in the hospital. We've visited folks who are in hospice, and we have visited our island home, the nursing home. She is a real pleasure to be with. She's 11 years old, a rescue dog, and she lives for treats, and maybe a little bit me too. So I'm gonna give her a treat before. But enough about me and Gwen. You can come up later and get some therapy from her if you'd like. She loves to be petted and be treated. I've gotten a few, and I'm going to start with on Zoom with Paul Connors, who has said that he wants to share an animal story. So let's see if we have Paul there.
Okay, can you hear me? Can you
Paul,
hear me?
Are you? Yep.
Okay, fine. Welcome to my family's merry menagerie of six different animals of six different species. The first, the female Afghan Sarissa. She was apricot colored. She was beautiful and she knew it. She was not interested in being petted. I love to parade her down Main Street and bask in people's reaction to her beauty. She was extremely fast. The ancient Egyptians used Afghans to hunt. And when she got loose, we would find her miles away. We felt privileged to share in the life of this queen. Second animal is Rusty, the male cat, orange. In the morning to get fed, he would awaken me. He would climb onto my bed and gently with a single claw touch my eyelid. While petting him, I discovered multiple bumps on his head. He got them sitting outside beneath the bird feeder, a victim of bird attack. We had a snake, a ball python, which we originally thought was a male. We called him Jared, but we found out he was a female, and now she's called Jaredina. To feed her, I would go to the pet store and purchase two live rats. If she would not eat them, I return the rats. The owner would say, "Here comes Mr. Rent-a-Rat." My grandson would walk down Main Street with the snake wrapped around his neck. And some moved far away and others came closer. For her checkups, we would take her to the odd pet vet. My daughter drove her across country to Seattle. She still thrives at the age of 27, with a lifespan of over 30. I never thought I could be comfortable with a snake 6 feet long. We had a parakeet we called Whizzer, and he would perch on my shoulder and pull in my whiskers. We had a chinchilla called Chuck, and to catch her, you could grab onto her prehensile tail. To protect her silky hair, we would bathe her in a bin filled with talcum powder. She would twirl around and causing a white storm. We had a hamster by the name of Spunky. He fell off the bed and had to have an eye removed, but he was still around as if nothing had happened. He lived up to his name. I would like to thank my daughter Danica for bringing these wonderful creatures into our lives. How much we loved all our animals and how much joy they gave us. Our home was truly an animal fair. Thank you.
Can everybody hear me?
Yep.
Oh, good. So years ago, I used to do pet therapy with this little cat named Missy that came from the Medfield Animal Shelter. She was Missy was a longtime resident of the shelter because she had a habit of going to a new home and peeing in unwanted places. So she'd come back, but I kind of felt like she liked the nursing home, and that's why she did that. But she was a tiger cat with a little stubby tail. That's her, if you can see her. She's in the sink in the shelter. But so I can't remember why I thought she would be able to tolerate going places, a cat leaving her home and going somewhere else and being plopped all over the place. But she actually liked leaving the shelter in a crate. And we used to go to the Thomas Upham Nursing Home in Medfield. I still go there now with my dog. That kind of thing runs in the family, I guess. And I felt like, it seemed like Missy was an angel. She was on a mission. I would take her in a crate to the shelter, to the nursing home, plop her on someone's bed, and she would just snuggle up with the resident of the bed, just relaxed and purring happily. And she was just amazing. She was totally at home, which felt like she had a job to do. Sometimes I would even bring her, and she liked rabbits too. So we would bring a rabbit from the shelter and put a rabbit and a bunny a rabbit and a cat on someone's bed. And I don't think it gets much more therapeutic than that. I don't think you can really think about much else with those two running around on your bed. But I had one lady, and I used to visit this one lady, Sylvia Tibbetts, my whole family knew her. And she had a roommate who was a lady from Brazil, who I didn't speak any English, but she seemed to really take to Missy. And sometimes her kids were there and they would say, they were just amazed. They said, who knew mom loved cats at this point in her life? And we sort of communicated and bonded to Missy. So finally, on one of my visits, it just happened that this woman, I can't remember her name, but she was really in her last moments of life and she was curled up in bed. And I just happened to be visiting, and they called me in, and I put Missy on her bed, and she just curled up, right on the crook of the woman's legs. I just tear up every time I think about it. But the kids were crying, and they just felt it was beautiful. They just loved it. It gave them closure and peace, and it was just an amazing scene that I'll never forget. But one little postscript, this man, I started training a man named Jim to take Missy to the shelter, to the nursing home. And he ended up adopting her. And he continued doing that on his own. So anyway, but inspired by all this, I went back to the shelter recently. And there was a volunteer there with a little feral cat outside. I asked her if she knew Missy. She said no, but come on inside. And I looked, and they had named, there's only two big cat rooms there, and the one cat room was named Missy's room. So she was a happy resident there for 9 years before she went home with Jim, and hopefully she's still alive because cats live a long time. But she was a wonderful angel with a stubby tail.
Thank you, Hen. Yeah. That was beautiful. Thank you. Okay, I was tearing up too. I don't know if Nancy here, Nancy Tobias. Yep, did you want to come and tell your story? Can she be there or you can be up here? It's up to you, Nancy. Okay.
I usually know when the phone, can you hear me, folks? I usually know when the phone rings and it's my daughter, it's going to be something in store for me. So, Madison Grace is a four-year-old Feist, came to me as my accidental dog. After putting my last kitty to sleep, which was a train of about 18 cats over the years, my daughter came to me with a proposition to take care of Maddie for just 2 weeks. She had a close friend with two dogs and she was looking for an apartment off island and needed just a little help. So I said, reluctantly, because I had just put a cat to sleep, and I said, no more animals. She said, I need a little help for no more than 2 weeks. Oops. 2 weeks turned out to be 5 weeks, and ended with the friend, my daughter's friend, coming and saying, can you please adopt Maddie? Madison Grace's name had changed to Maddie by the time the 5 weeks went by. So I didn't think about it too long, because by that time I was in love with Maddie. No one would let this lady rent an apartment with two dogs. Yeah, I wasn't surprised. Maddie is smart, loyal, affectionate, and very funny. She has a spot on the couch and a pillow in her spot. Well, actually, the whole couch is hers. She sits facing two French doors and windows all around so that she can watch and look out wherever she wants. She does allow people to come and sit down, but not when they come too close to her pillow. The most fun I have is I have a TV set in the bedroom, and when a commercial comes on, not all commercials, certain commercials, up she flies off the couch into the bedroom on the end of my bed and watches the commercials. Some of the commercials she absolutely loves, never takes her eyes away from them, and she picks them out and goes in every time they come on. Other commercials, she goes in, but she's mad when she sees them. So the commercial she really gets upset about is, I don't know why, it's a sandals commercial where two people are out on a surfboard paddling around having a lovely time. But it makes her mad and she barks like crazy at this commercial. The other commercial she barks at, not because she doesn't like the commercial, but because I don't feed her farmer's dog. So she flies in there, and the whole time the commercial's on, she's barking, and she looks at me like, did you get it? I really would like farmer's dog. She also makes sure that I walk 7 days a week, usually a mile and a half, on any day that a human and a dog can possibly walk on this island. And a lot of times I walk her twice a day. And she keeps me laughing every day. So thank you, Maddie.
Okay, we've had the Zoomers. I think we're on to, I don't know if Rob and Arlene want to come up separately or together, or, and you can be there or you can come up here. It's up to you.
In my life before I came to Nantucket, I was fortunate to raise alpaca for a period of time. And this story is about one particular alpaca named Rita. We had about 30 animals at this point, and we were in the process of selling them, and no ones are born as the process goes. And we had sold some, and I had resisted selling Rita because she was one of the special ones. She was more friendly than most. She was a little taller. Her head was up about this height. She was black. And eventually the time did come to sell her, reluctantly. And so I trailered her to a farm that we had sold animals to before. And this is why I finally relented on selling Rita, because she was going to where other nice animals we'd had were. So we get out of the trailer, and I'm carrying by halter her up to around, out of the trailer, around the corner, and she stops and just kind of, you know, puts her brakes on and leans into me, you know, as a dog will lean into you when they're petting them. And there was this, where am I going, sense about her. And so we took a couple of steps forward, and then the animals we had sold to that farm came up to the fence, and she recognized them. and then was relaxed and everything was fine. And the happy ending was that as I took her into the field, she ran off with the other animals that we had been fond of raising. So that's the story of Rita.
My story is a little more autobiographical in that it starts in 1954. 1954 was a very big year for me. I entered school for the first time. I had no idea that I would have 68 more first days of school to enter. As a student, as a teacher, and finally as a head of three different schools, I didn't know what the future held in store. It was also a monumental year because I got my first puppy. Rusty came in to our lives, to my life and my two sisters, and I had been begging for this, begging. My father, who was working at a construction site, saw the litter of puppies. The mother apparently had given birth in a shed, and they were hoping that the men on the job would take some of them home. So that's how Rusty came to be. And I still remember walking into the kitchen. It was winter. We had a stove that had legs on it. It was a very old stove. And I saw this fur ball underneath the stove, and I couldn't believe my eyes. From that day forward, I was sold on the concept of this animal was not an animal. It was something with a soul, and it was mine, and I was going to take really good care of it. Little did I know that for the next, how many would it be if I did the math right, 69 years, I would never be without a dog. And when I say never be without a dog, I actually followed Mary Oliver's advice in taking your dog to work with you. The three schools that I headed, in my contract I had written and signed that I was allowed to have my dogs at school. So they came with me every day, first to a K-8 girls' school where Sarah and Baxter gave out all the love, and they came for the cookies and all the rest of it. And then on to Los Angeles through a 6-12 school where I had the love of my life, Grace Louise, Amazing Grace, 168-pound Newfoundland, who the girls were crazy about, and would come to the office and walk, and then back to San Francisco for the last 14 years to, K-12 school. So from 5-year-old to 18-year-old, the kids were there all the time. If the door was open to either of the offices, they were there. They were there to supposedly take care of the animals, but they were taking care of themselves. Dogs were very popular on test days, and whenever there was a little bit of tension, there they were. So that was my experience through my life with my dogs. Luckily, that has continued to this day. But I also owe my life twice to my dogs. First time was in 1951 when I was diagnosed very unexpectedly with a failing heart, and I had emergency open heart surgery. It was my Newfoundland who got me through the recovery period. And I say that in all sincerity. I don't know that I would have gone through it all if I hadn't had the dog to take care of and to live for. And for 4 months, the animal never left my side. My sister couldn't drag her out to the park, couldn't take her anywhere. She was there constantly. I got better than most. Obviously, I'm living proof that it worked pretty well. But that was the love of my life with Gracie. More recently, 3 years ago when Rob and I met, walking in the Pocono Mountains, we were attacked by a black bear. And I, of course, I'm sure you have all read things about don't run, act big or whatever you're supposed to wave your hands. I'm here to tell you, if the bear is running at you at about 30 miles an hour, run. Because standing still means you are going to be lunch. And we had our two dogs. We saw off in the distance what looked like a big black bear, and it was, and cubs behind it. But they walked far away, way beyond where this building would be. But when the mother sensed our dogs, unfortunately, she turned around and ran for us. Rob has a poodle, Jackson, and I know that I owe my life to that dog. Luckily, he lives with us, so I get to make it up to him for the rest of his life. But what happened in a nutshell was she came to attack. I ran, got behind a tree. Tree had a fork in it. Bear was on the other side. And I can actually give you vivid detail of what the inside of a bear's mouth looks like because she was trying to get through the tree. During the same time, Rob is doing the, you know, yelling and all the rest of it. But here is a poodle jumping at a 300-pound bear and jumping and jumping and jumping. Just enough for me to run from behind to around the back of the house and then through the woods. Rob had Jackson's leash, harness, which he had pulled out of. He got the bear to chase him. He was very happy to sacrifice himself as long as I was going to get out. And I could see him going up the road as I started to run. And as I got a little further, the bear turned around to come at me the second time, and he turned around to get the bear. The second time, in her annoyance, she took off after him in the woods. And here's Rob, his dog is gone. And I got to run away and got saved. Well, when I saw that dog come out of the woods, I will never forget that moment because I thought for sure that she had become what the bear was after. We were told afterwards that the bear had been through some tough times with her three cubs, whether it had been attacked by dogs or whatever, that something really bad had happened. And it was also understanding that the bear was willing to give up her life because she had three cubs and she was going to take care of them. But when I look back, you know, over the times in my life and I think about all of that, I know dogs and animals have souls. I mean, I know it in my own soul, that if I have one, they at least have that. And I often think about Mark Twain, Samuel Clemens, who wrestled with his love of his dogs and whether or not they had souls, and his famous line about, if dogs don't go to heaven, I don't want to go there. I don't either. Thank you.
I don't think I can take much more. Thank you. That was lovely. That was lovely. Does anybody, I promise, if anybody did feel a spontaneous desire to talk about an animal that had meaning for them, I don't want to leave you out if you do want to say something about an animal. Otherwise, you can come up and share with me later if you don't want to talk in front but of everybody. But anybody have an animal story? I've got plenty, but I'm going to keep them to myself. The next thing is our musical interlude. Okay, so you can think about your animals. Well, we're hearing some George Winston.
Thank you.
I'm having Paul come up to do the words for the offering. I want to mention before he does that afterwards we have Jim Sulzer singing a song that he wrote for a service we did about animals quite a while ago, a few years ago. And it's a beautiful song. I love hearing it, and I appreciate that Jim is here to sing it for us again. Their lyrics are in your order of service, I believe, and they're beautiful lyrics as well. I'm going to leave it to Paul.
Thank you. You know, we're really lucky here. We're really lucky to have Susan and Peter and Barbara and Jim and Deirdre and the rest of this week's crew to create a lovely service. We're lucky here in this Unitarian Universalist congregation, in this lovely meeting house on this lovely island. We're very lucky to have the company of friends and to have the company of our wild friends on this island and in this world. I've been enjoying a little group of snakes that overnighted in my bulkhead all summer. My son came and discovered them and was very excited to tell me about them. But they keep coming back every night, pretty much. I have my cat Bam Bam that sits on my knee every chance she gets. I made a really interesting observation the other day. Bam Bam likes to snooze on the back of my office chair, kind of snuggled up against my neck. And I was kind of taken by that, and I decided to take a selfie with her snuggling me. And you know how the camera sort of frames the faces of the people in the photograph? Anyway, it framed her as well as me, which just goes to show you how similar we all are. We're all in this together, Bam Bam and I, you and I. We're a good team, and we're very lucky. Our generous contributions will now be gratefully received.
How can we know if we see you true, you creatures of the air? If there was some way we could follow you, then we might show you how we can. You ride the heavens in a wheel of glory, in bursts of color and of light. How can we ever really know your story? How can we ever get it right? How can we know if we hear you true, you creatures of the land? If there was some way we could talk to you, we might try and understand. You fill the earth with your sounds of living, you bark and growl and purr and bleed. How can we ever know what you are given? How can we make our bond complete? How can we know if we feel you true, you creatures of the sea? If there was some way we could ride with you, then we might know you wild and free. You ply the depths in a swirl of mystery, you move with speed and magic grace. How can we ever know your secret history? How can we ever know your face? Air and water, son and daughter, can we ever know?
Thank you.
I love that. You actually sent me a little clip of the audio clip. I have that. I listen to it every once in a while. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Well, if everybody could stand for our doxology, we'll sing that before we sing hymn number 1008. From all that dwells below the skies, let faith and hope with love arise. Let beauty, truth, and good be sung through every land, by every tongue. Amen. And now in your teal hymnal, 1008, when our heart is in a holy place. You can come forward and we'll extinguish the chalice. New words in your order of service again for the extinguishing of the chalice. You can say as Peter does his duty. Never has it been more true than now. We extinguish this flame, but the sparks within us remain alight. From each of us in our supposed solitude, the signals buzz and hum, sparkling through space one to another, connecting us invisibly but palpably. We are one. Tree, forest, jungle, river, lake, and ocean, together our light shines. Thank you, Peter. I have chosen as closing words, a few weeks ago, actually maybe in winter now, we had a visiting minister, Keith Cron, who is a transitional, he's a UUA transitional director, helping us find our way to finding another minister. And he had a wonderful story that I asked him to share with me. And I'm going to read through that short story. It has a couple of animals in it, of course. And it's called Unclenching. But I think it has meaning for our human world as well. You may remember it if you were at the service. It was a nearly perfect summer day for a walk, and I wasn't alone. My favorite sighting on my street in Providence was a woman walking her adorable French bulldog down the street. I heard, "Good boy, Luke," several times as she pulled slightly on the leash to keep Luke from being too distracted. Around the corner comes a man with a pit bull. Luke immediately goes stock still. The pit bull is wagging her tail with the greatest of hope and charm, clearly excited about the possibility of a new friend. She won me over. The woman tries to get Luke to move forward, in vain this time as the French bulldog is playing statue. Eventually, the man with the pit bull reaches the woman and her dog. If possible, the French bulldog gets even stiffer. The woman is trying to say to Luke that it's okay, and the pit bull sniffs hopefully and inquisitively at her new wish-for friend. And then in an instant, Luke relaxes and sniffs back. And quickly, their tails are all a-wagging as the sniff and nuzzle and snort. I notice the owners have relaxed and then have unclenched, and they are now talking amiably, though near as I can tell, their tails are not a-wagging with the same veracity as their pets. It's only then that I realize I had been clenching and now feel my body relaxing. I left the happy foursome and headed off, thinking how much of a metaphor this has become for today's times, how we all seem to be living lives of trepidation, and yet hope and kindness are out there if we look beyond the stereotypes, if we present ourselves with kindness, if we can just try. I thought about what reputations pit bulls have, and yet she was the kindest of them all. Maybe in these difficult and trying times, we need to be more like the pit bull in whatever ways we can, offering a little hope and kindness to those new friends we might make. Thanks, everyone, for coming. Feel free to come.